This is something we put on with a whole bunch of different folks. I'm here, Matthew's here, and we're going to be presenting results. And then we'll have the teams come up and actually sort of talk about what they did. I'm going to introduce everything to you. Depending on how timing is, I will either stay or run to go get my flight. So we'll see. But that's why Matthew's here, so he can sort of finish everything up if I have to go. Yeah, okay. Next slide. Scroll the slide. Okay. Keep scrolling. Okay. So we have very, very good technology here. So let me get started by talking about the sort of the background and the setup. This is a talk on language model extraction. Language models basically just sort of work by generating text. I'm sure we've all seen how these go. You know, you put in a prompt, it gives you some output. Hopefully the output is some novel generation that's been never seen before, but this may not always be the case. In particular, when you have text that comes from something like trained on user emails or something, this might be bad if it was memorized data that was actually being emitted instead of just novel generation. So we want to be able to understand to what extent models spit out data that comes from a training data set versus actual like benign novel generations. Okay. So just like there are not that many of us in this room, how many people here are familiar with like how you do like training data extraction from language models? I guess, are there lots of people who aren't? Should I sort of relatively quickly go through it? I'll skim the results. Okay, good. Okay. I don't want to waste people's time, but okay. So here's how you extract training data from large language models. Two steps. Step one, you generate a lot of data. This is easy. If you just sort of ask language models for data, they give it to you. Like, this is the purpose of a language model, it is to spit out text. So you ask a language model for text, and it will give you lots and lots and lots of text. Okay. This step is easy. The second step is what's hard. The second step in an extraction attack, sometimes you need to be able to predict which of the sequences of text were training examples and which of them are novel generations. Okay. It turns out that there are techniques that let you do this. So for example, if you sort of run what's called a membership inference attack on all this generated text, it can sort of highlight for you the sequences that happen to come from the training data set. Okay. This is the idea of what we're going to do. How do you actually implement something like that? What you do is you use a membership inference attack. And all they really rely on is the fact that examples that were memorized tend to have high confidence. So let's imagine that I ask the language model, you know, what the likelihood of the sentence, my phone number is 00012334. And it told me there's like a 1% chance of this sentence occurring. This might be relatively low, and I think, okay, like this is not memorized because it's a fairly low likelihood. But if I ask the model the same thing, but you know, what about my phone number being 555679, and it told me there's an 80% chance of this occurring, this would be unusually high. And so I might be surprised by that, and I might think that as a result, this is not just being some novel generation, it probably is the case that the model memorized this particular example. So, at a very high level, this is how these membership inference attacks work. And of course, you can do much better, and part of the competition here is to be able to design better methods to do this. Okay. So, this is what you do to extract training data. We're just going to generate a lot of data, and then we're going to predict which of them are memorized. Okay, so, a while ago, 2 years ago, we did a case study analysis of this on GPT-2. We tried to understand how much training data does GPT-2 memorize, and how much can we get out of it. When we actually ran this analysis, the why GPT-2? At the time, the reason we did GPT-2, for three reasons. The first reason was that it was sort of the best model anyone had at the time. This is no longer true, but at the time, it was the best model. It's sort of a public model. Anyone can download it. This is good for science. And it was trained on a mostly public data set, which let us check if our extraction attack actually succeeded. You need some sorts of ground truth, and we know where it came from, so we can check if we succeeded. The data set, so while the data source was public, the OpenAI never released the 40 gigabyte data set itself that they actually trained on, which meant that we had to do a little bit of manual analysis to actually check if things worked, but for the most part it was pretty good. So, in the paper that we wrote previously, 600,000 donations. Of these, we sort of determined 1,800 of them were potentially memorized, and then with manual verification, we filtered this down to 604 that were actually memorized. Okay, so this is, you know, a lot of memorization, but like it's 600 examples. The problem with this is like 600 examples out of a 40 gigabyte data set is a very, very, very small number, right? We never believed this was an upper bound. We only wanted to claim like extraction is possible, and here's a lower bound of what you can achieve. Question then is like, you know, is this really a problem? Like, what is the upper bound look like? So in more recent work, what we've done is we've tried to compute an upper bound to be able to understand what you can actually do with like maybe the strongest attack that was possible. Okay, so there's a paper, quantifying memorization across neural language models we wrote last year. And we have in the paper we have some charts, which will appear momentarily. thank you for putting up with this. So the way that what we're doing is we sort of vary various parameters. This is for a different kind of model. But sort of high level, if you look at the plot on the left, we're able to give an upper bound on memorization on like order, like single digit percentage of the data set being memorized. This is, you know, exact configuration to sort of the dependent, but it's relatively high compared to the previous number. So, you know, I can now tell you the true rate of memorization is somewhere between 0.00001% and 5%. Okay, so this is sort of a bound, but it is not a very tight bound. And that's so basically the problem that we want to address. We want to ask the question, like, can we make this bound something more useful? And so that's what we wanted to do here. We wanted to construct a competition in order to close the gap and see if we can develop better extraction attacks that will move the lower bound up, and then maybe separately at another time, we'll try and do better upper bounds to move the upper bound to be lower. And we're gonna try and sort of push from both ends so we can better establish like how much memorization these models actually have. Okay, so that's what we're gonna be doing. And you can skip, I think, two slides. This one, there you go. So we made a competition, we put it on GitHub, and we asked people to enter, and people did. So I'm going to tell you what the competition actually looks like, what the setup of the competition was, and then we'll hear from the participants on how they actually went to solve it. Okay. So there's two questions when you set up this competition. The first question is, what model are you going to use? And the second question is, what data set are you going to use? Okay. So for the model, we're no longer going to use GPT-2. GPT-2 was great. It sort of introduced all of this large language modeling stuff to the community, but the data set that it was trained on is not public. So it's very hard to actually use this for really rigorous science. So instead what we're gonna do is we're gonna use GPT-NEO 1.3 billion. This is an open source reproduction of GPT-2. It was trained on a data set that's public, the entire model is public, you know, everything is known about this model, so we don't need to guess about anything OpenAI may or may not have done. Okay, why this model? I mean, basically it's the same story to why GPT-2 in the first place. I mean, it's not actually state-of-the-art anymore, right? We have GPT-3, GPT-3.5, we have OPT, we have all these sort of crazy large models that are available now. But it's still quite good. Like, it's a 1.3 billion parameter model. It is an entirely reasonable language model. It's worth studying. Again, the model is public. You can download it. We know everything about the model. But what's even better is that the data set is actually entirely public, too. So you can download all of the data that the model is trained on, and you can study the data set in order to figure out what's going on here. And in particular, this lets us construct an evaluation set for a challenge. So we used the data set that this was trained on, called the PIL. The PIL is an 800 gigabyte data set of text that was scraped from the internet. So all the data from the PIL is public, but it's sort of scraped from the internet, and it was used to train GPT, 1.3 billion GPT. So, that's data set, that's model. Now we need to talk about how we actually evaluate how well an attack works on this model, on this data set. So there are a bunch of things you might imagine trying to do. Maybe the simplest thing you can try and do is to measure something like the recall. Like, let's just measure what fraction of the data set I can recover out of the model. This is fine, but it has some problems. Okay, so what's the problem with recall? The first step problem with recall is there are, I could get very, very high score on recall by just making very bland observations. You know, probably the model memorizes the string. This software is provided as is without warranty of any kind. You know, if I were to guess this is from a training data set, I would like score very, very highly because this is probably contained in the training data set 100,000 times. And so it's not very interesting to be able to guess this. There are lots of other things I can guess as well that I can extract from the model without ever interacting with the model just because I know what kind of distribution the data was trained on. And so we don't want to allow people to sort of just like, who can generate the most bland English text? You know, like you can sort of score very, very highly from doing very uninteresting things. The other problem with measuring just recall is that more compute just makes the numbers go up. Like if you're measuring recall, you should just generate as many sequences as possible and you will score strictly better than someone who generates fewer sequences, and there's no reason to not just spend more and more compute. And the final problem is that you have no penalty for making mistakes. And so you can imagine by some like million monkeys argument, you should just spit out everything you possibly can because worst case it's not training data and there's no penalty. Okay. So we're not just going to do this straight recall measurement. Let's try and do something maybe a little bit better. You can imagine trying to switch from untargeted extraction to targeted extraction. So what do I mean by this? If straight recall is just measuring what percent of the training data can you recover, if instead we measure what fraction of the time can you succeed at extracting particular examples, we can just make sure we never include examples that are boring in some sense. Or if we do include one, we like only include one of those, and just make sure that most of what we're measuring is the ability of people to extract interesting sequences. So the way we're going to do this is we're going to construct this test set by taking the training data set, splitting it into a prefix and a suffix for each sequence. We're going to provide you the prefix and ask you to predict the suffix. This makes the task sort of well specified. Like the objective of the task is that you want to guess what the suffix is going to be given the prefix. Now you can imagine what happens if there are multiple suffixes that correspond to the same prefix. We just enumerate all possible prefixes and all suffixes and just make sure this isn't the case. So we just sort of discard any cases, so we make sure the task is completely well specified. And now, given some prefix, there's only one suffix that it corresponds to in the training data set. And so we give you the prefix and the language model and ask you to predict what the suffix is for that prefix, and either you succeed or you don't succeed. So this is better, right? It's going to help some. It's going to help resolve, in particular, the first issue. So you sort of look at the problems before, like, the first one's done, right? Like, we've removed the failure mode where you can score very highly from by just guessing at bland sentences because we're telling you which things you have to extract. So you can't just guess. But the remaining two problems are still around. So we're not just going to do this. We're going to try and do a little bit better than that. In particular, we're going to just do a targeted extraction and just add precision and time constraints. It simplifies the problem now. And there are a couple ways you can imagine doing this. You could imagine measuring, you know, recall against time, and then having a precision constraint, like a hard constraint on precision. You must hit, I don't know, 50% precision. And this would be useful because it would tell you how you trade off, like, compute resources against what recall is. Or what you can do is you could measure recall against precision. In particular, you could measure, like, recall against the number of errors that are made. And then you can fix the time constraints. We decided to go with this for this competition because we wanted to make it like sort of a fairly standard compute and sort of put everyone on the same threshold for compute and then sort of try and optimize the sort of the details of the attack. It's fairly standard in the literature to have these precision recall curves, and we thought it was better to do this and fix the compute resources as opposed to varying the compute resources. So in particular, what we do is we just sort of pick a particular threshold of, let's say, 24 hours of compute, and then we sort of draw a threshold for the competition, and we'll say, like, we'll measure at this one point for scoring the competition. But in general, we think this curve is sort of the right way of looking at these kinds of extraction attacks. Okay, I think that I'm at the, oh, I see, yes, okay. One more thing I need to tell you about. I'm going to tell you how do we construct the memorization test set. Okay, so what are we actually going to do? This is going to be a fairly simple set of steps. First thing we're going to do is we're going to take the training data. That's going to be a fun set of slides to go through. Okay. I should not have done animations. Okay, so we take the training data set, next slide. Then we're going to split the sample into this prefix suffix form, as sort of I told you we're going to do. And then what we're going to do is we're going to keep only these examples so that when you query the language model on the prefix, you get the suffix. Okay, so why are we doing this? We want to make sure that we're not asking someone to do something that's impossible. Like, you can imagine there are lots of sequences in the language model and data set that are just not memorized. And we don't want people to try and have to extract things that are just impossible. All right, so we're going to make the task so that the solution definitely exists guaranteed. This is a problem, though, because now it looks like everyone can succeed because you just passed a prefix into the language model and you're guaranteed to get the suffix. So how do we make this a competition? What we do is we split the prefix into its own sequence. The pre-prefix, and we have the rest of the stuff. We're going to take this pre-prefix thing, and we're just going to drop it. We're not going to give you that. We're only going to give you the last piece of the prefix. So like, this is partial information. It's still completely a targeted attack, but now you don't have all of the context that actually made it so we could find the solution, but it's like most of the context. And now we just give the adversary just this sort of extra stuff, like the remaining part of the prefix, and ask them using that to try and predict what the suffix is going to be. And it turns out that just doing this, you'll only score maybe 10% of the time. And so there's a lot of work you have to do in order to be able to get the rest of the way there. Okay, I think that, yes, very good. Okay, so we're gonna go to results in a second, but before we do that and let other people talk, I want to first clear up any questions on the setup of the competition so that other people are not sort of left with any problems that I made by explaining what we're doing. So, questions on the setup. I am sure that I have left something out because I made these slides up until like 5 minutes ago, and I've never given this, sort of explained this to anyone before. So I'm sure that I've left something out. So please tell me what is not clear. Okay.
So how did you do this split into prefix and suffix? So do you take the rolling window of the data, or do you take
the very good question. How do we split into the prefix and suffix? Do we do a rolling window or something? Okay. This is someone who entered the competition, they have a question. If they have a question, I guarantee you that someone else in this room has a question. So while I'm answering this, someone else please come up with another question. Okay, so what we did is we considered all possible substrings of the 800 gigabyte training data set of 200 tokens. This is a lot of possible substrings, but we just considered all of them. We went through all of them, and then we looked for which substrings of at least 200 tokens are repeated in the training data set at least 5 times. We know that repetition tends to correlate with extraction, and so we try and find things that are repeated at least 5 times. And then this gives us roughly a set of, I think, like 1 million examples. We take these 1 million examples and we put them all through the model. And we try and take, of these things that we put through the model, which ones are memorized. And then we sort of just brute force from there. It tells us which ones we can possibly extract. And then we do this sort of split into the pre-prefix, the remaining part of the prefix and the sentence. Yeah. Yes? So is there any constraint on what? Yeah, okay, so all of these were fixed length. So we gave people 50 tokens and we asked them to complete the next 50. Yeah. That was sort of this nice and easy, sort of, you can stack as an empire, right? Mostly the reason why. Yeah.
Sorry, about the precision recall thing. Are you asking people to submit multiple?
Okay, very good. Okay, this is a question that I did not answer at all in the talk, and someone should have asked me about it. Thank you. Okay, so how do you submit a solution, and what are we scoring by? So what we did is we asked people to submit an ordered list of guesses. So they would guess, like, on example 12, I think this is the answer. On example 15, I think this is the answer. On example 30, I think this is the answer. And then maybe they might go back and guess on 12 again, and they get another answer. And what we were going to do is we're going to measure sort of, you could use this to compute a recall versus number of errors plot by just walking down the ordered list one at a time. And we're going to finally score based on recall at 100 errors, which is sort of arbitrarily picked. But this was the metric we're going to use. We had 1,000 examples in our test set. We ask people to go by recall at 100 errors. Does this make sense?
So you provide, you know, the base, and then they propose, we think that this is the
suffix. Yeah, so we provide the prefix, and then they send to us a suffix, and then we send them back, sort of, we can sort of judge yes or no.
And then they provide several examples of it, like what they think in a row, and then you find out how many does it take to get to 100 errors.
Yeah, so they provide all the guesses all at once, and then we sort of walk through and we say how many do you get before you make your 100th error. Yes. Okay.
So if I have like 49 words in the suffix correct and the last one wrong, it's still an error.
Yeah, so if you had 49 correct and the last one wrong, it's still an error, yes. Why did we go that way? Because it's easier. I completely agree. In practice, I looked at this a little bit. If you got like 80% of the sequence correct, the probability you got all of it correct is like 90%. So like, possibly you might have scored another 10% or something like that. Usually if you made an error, you just sort of diverge and you go. It's very rare that you have extracted 49 words and just make the 50 word wrong. But in practice, it could be possible. We didn't count it. And yeah, that's sort of the limitation of what we're doing.
So since you dropped the
is the problem logically equivalent to guessing the prefix? In some sense, yes. I guess the one thing I'll mention about this also is the pile data set is public. So one thing to know about this competition is that cheating is trivial. Right? You grep, prefix, lookup, suffix, return answer. Okay, so what do? We just say, please don't. We had no prizes or anything. We just sort of, we were trying to make scientific progress and we asked people not to cheat. In the same way that you could train on the ImageNet validation set and I'd say, look, I got 100%. Like, just don't do that. Yeah.
So you said you split the prefix into pre-prefix and the rest to avoid that you were just plugging the whole thing.
Yeah.
But isn't the rest still important? Doesn't that still get you somewhere?
Yeah, it's exactly. So yeah, we split it into these three pre-trunks. The idea is that the rest piece, like this middle prefix, is still informative. It still does tell you something about what's going to come, and this is how we control, like, to make there be a unique solution. But if you take that and you predict what the remaining part is, you'll only score about 10%.
Right.
So you're not going to, like, so
that's a benchmark.
Yeah, but this is sort of the very, very naive benchmark. We have a slightly better benchmark than that. I'll talk about this in a second.
Is the definition for prioritization of these competitions similar to the one?
Yes. Yeah. So the definitions are very similar.
Do you verify that the rest only appears once in the dataset, so that if you have a different prefix than the rest, if you have a different suffix?
Yes, we verify that the rest with like the prefix thing concatenated with the suffix is unique, and that we also did some other verification. For example, we checked that the suffix was not contained in the prefix because you don't want to like have the answer only because like the document repeated itself twice. We verify that the entropy of the suffix was sufficiently high. You don't want the suffix to just be all spaces. There were some other things we did to make sure that it's somewhat non-trivial, and sort of reduced it down to a set of 20,000 like total interesting examples. Of this, we took 10,000. We declared that to be a training set, which the people can sort of do whatever they want on. We declared 1,000 to be a validation set. We made that public. And the final 1,000 are a test set. We're going to hold the test set private. The idea for this is we wanted to start by doing this once. We want to just leave this running, so we would like it if people could just submit to us things whenever they want, if they do better at traction attacks. And the air conditioning is really loud, wow. And then you can ideally just like send it to us, and we'll only be the only ones with the test set, so people will like not, like they can sort of actually do validation on the validation set, and then have it be a test set that sort of verifies stuff going on. Okay. Other questions on the setup? Very good, okay. Let's start with results then. Okay, so we received 3 submissions. Okay, what does this tell us? It tells us training data extraction is actually really hard. A bunch of people asked us questions, but then didn't submit anything. 2 of them beat the baseline by quite a lot. 1 of them didn't beat the baseline, had some bugs, and didn't follow the rules. And I tried to sort of communicate with them, and they were not as responsive, and so I'm hopeful that at some point they'll sort of be able to sort of get things going, but so for now, we'll hear from both the people who both beat the baseline, and let me talk a little bit about what the baseline did. I think you can, okay, so this is what the curves look like for the 3 people who, for like the baseline and the 2 people who beat it. The baseline's in purple. What does the baseline do? Given each training document, like each potential thing we should be going by, it predicts like 100 possible guesses what the suffix could be. It then sorts them all by likelihood and just returns them in this order. So you have like, so a test set with 1,000 examples. So you have 100 times 1,000 possible generations. It sorts them all by likelihood and just returns them in sequential order. So this is sort of it's not the most naive baseline. It's like, this was what like we did in our extraction paper. This is sort of the state of the art. It's like you generate things a lot of times and you sort by likelihood. And so we internally had tried to do better than this for a little bit of time and we didn't get too much better than that. So like achieving better than this baseline is hard. We tried, for example, increasing the compute by a factor of 100, and like it did a little bit better, but not by much. So you can't just beat this baseline by throwing more compute at it. We have more compute than you do. and it's hard. Yeah. Okay. So now let's sort of start going to what people actually ended up doing, and for that we're going to have the second place team. Did a little bit better, and I think Matthew, you can talk.
I don't know what they did, but they have a nice video that we might be able to play if my laptop speakers are loud enough. And they got 0.301, which, as you can see, is greater than 0.247. Anything else you think that should be said? Okay. And then, drum roll, please. Team one? Oh, sorry, that was team two's name. congratulations to everyone on the slide. I don't think anyone managed to make it, which is why we have a recorded video. And then we already gave them the drum roll, but 0.383, as you can see, is much bigger than either of us. And that was team three. So congratulations to team three. We have a representative of team three here. It's Ali. Two. Oh, well, congratulations. Very well deserved applause. I think we can just, the video, let's try to get this video playing.
I guess worst case we'll post it after.
Yeah. This is playing on my laptop.
Ranking them by perplexity, which you see the straight is equation.
Negative Chinese.
Yes,
I can just do that. Yeah. But the table is not going to. Okay, that's fine.
And I know that our presentation is not the most airtight right now, but don't let that detract from all the hard work that the competitors did. It's really, really cool to see people competing in this challenge and trying to push the state of the art on training data extraction. So really, really appreciate it.
Okay, is this any better?
So we explored improved surface generation and improved surface ranking, and we first introduced several phenomena and then introduced the tricks based on these phenomena. So these three figures are all the histograms of the token lodges. So this one is all the tokens. So this one is the first generated token, and the middle one, and last generated tokens. And we can see clearly that there are differences between the largest distribution of ground truth and generation. So we examine the effects of a variety of NLP techniques, such as we change the sampling strategy, or we adjust the probability distribution. So we try top K sampling, nuclear sampling, and locally typical sampling. And we can observe that the tendency of top K and typical sampling is the same as some other tasks, language tasks, such as summarization or story generation. Yeah, but in English sampling, the tendency is different. So we can also adjust the temperature or the repetition penalty to make the probability distribution different from the original generated distribution. Yeah. And the second types of methods are based on the exposure bias. And by saying exposure bias, we're actually saying that for efficient vectorization, it is common practice to pack or truncate multiple sentences into fixed length sequences when training language models. So it's different when we are generating suffixes. So we want to mimic the training settings. And the first is to use a dynamic context window. The length of the training window may differ from the length of the extraction window. And as a result, we propose to adjust the context window size. Like it can start from the beginning of the sentence or the middle of the sentence, to mimic, you know, the training settings. So we also encourage the results of the different context window sizes to collaborate in determining the next generated token. And the equations and the explanations of the equations are much more in details in the paper. So we can also use dynamic position shifting. It is because the positional embeddings are added to the token feature in models like GPT-NL. And during training, this is added per batch of sentences, causing the same sentence to have different offsets in positional embeddings in different training batches. And they are different in training and in generation. So to improve the extraction of memorized suffixes, we propose to recover the positions used during training by evaluating different shifted positions and selecting the best one. Like we use different positions here, and then we select which position yields the best results. Yeah. And from this table, we can see that the effect of the context window dynamic context window is pretty obvious, but the effect of dynamic position shifting is not as expected. Yeah. And the third one is based on that we observed that the generated suffix can be only a slightly different from the ground truth suffix. So we want to like look one step or multiple steps ahead and using the probability of the subsequent tokens to inform the generation of the current token. Yeah, it can be realized by looking multiple steps, but considering the computational cost, we only use the first step looking ahead as this in this equation. And the results show that the effectiveness of looking ahead is pretty convincing. Yeah. And we know that in the basic setup, we use perplexity as the ranking criteria. Yeah, but the ground truth sentences do not consistently have the lowest perplexity values. So we propose additional ranking metrics to address this disparity. We use Zlib and to help together with the perplexity, and we also use this comp product in this equation. And this high confidence method, it is because we assume that if the model memorizes some certain patterns, it exhibits a high level of confidence. So in this method, if a sentence contains confident tokens, we rank this sentence higher. And this surprise patterns, this trick is inspired by some previous observations, by some previous words, that human text generation, it frequently exhibits a pattern in which tokens with high perplexity are intermittently included. So this is called surprise patterns. And in this trick, we encourage this type of surprise patterns. Yeah, and in this table, the results of the previous four criteria is illustrated. So this is the overall evaluation of all the previous mentioned tricks, and you can also see it in this link. And thanks. If you have further questions or some discussions, then you can just email me.
Yeah, so please feel free to contact them if you have questions. And
yeah, so that was Rich and their bag of tricks. That was a nice talk. I'm glad that you all were able to listen to it. But now we have the winners of the competition, the greatest training data extractors in the world. Come on up.
Do you want to bring your laptop also?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine.
Now what happened to the jacket?
Oh, great.
Now it works.
Nicholas is flying home.
Yeah, I have a flight in an hour and 15 minutes, so I can't say sorry.
I'll close the shop down. I've never heard this in my life.
Where is that music coming from?
It's not from my laptop, I believe.
I'll just get started despite the musician. But so welcome everyone. Glad that so many people could be here. So I'm Ali, I'm presenting our training data extraction challenge solution. And we're team Ace New Delft from the University of Delft. And today I'll show our two-phase strategy, which is kind of like what Nicholas already presented. And we will show a 34% improvement of the baseline. And while doing that, we also try to minimize the performance penalty over the baseline solution, and we also consider a relatively constrained adversary as a manageable. So I'll start with giving a quick overview of our attack. So as I just mentioned, our focus is on doing a relatively fast attack. So we give quite limited capabilities to the adversary. Mainly, we only provide query access. The adversary does not get access to the inner ways of the model. He only gets, he's only allowed to query the model and to access the loss of the model on a specific sample. And we only do polynomial time operations, so meaning that we don't train any other models or anything. We don't tune the GPT model further. And we don't have access to the base model, so we don't train any shadow models either. Our overview of the attack, we start by generating multiple candidate suffixes per prefix. So for a single prefix, we generate, in this case, 100 suffixes. Then we apply membership inference attack to see which of the suffixes is the correct one. And we also try to order them by the one that we have the most confidence in. Drawn out the attack here. So it starts by prompting the GPT model just with the prompt B. We don't change the prompt in any way. And get a number of suffixes per prompt. And in this case, we want to maximize the recall. So getting as many correct suffixes as possible. And then afterwards, we apply a membership inference attack to basically maximize the precision, meaning that we want to minimize the amount of suffixes that we have and order them in the correct way such that the most correct ones or the ones most likely to be correct are at the top of our solution. Okay, I'll start by explaining how we implemented the generation step. So as I mentioned, we optimized the recall here. So what we wanted, what we did was we looked at the number of different generation or decoding strategies for the model. We looked at greedy, which is the standard one used by the most transformer models, contrastive, and deep search. And what the results show is that contrastive search tends to work best in this case, works better than greedy, while also still being relatively quick. And that also scales up if we increase the number of generations. So if we do between 10 and 100 generations per prefix, we see a relatively big difference in the amount of samples that we are actually able to extract for. We also tried beam search. So while for a few beams, it does seem to work well, as we scale it up, the performance decreases, and it's also too slow, too memory intensive to really use. So contrastive search is the one that we went with. And then a quick example of the extraction that we actually did. So in blue is the, it's hard to see here, but in blue is the prefix. And then we generated a number of suffixes. I show 4 here, and I've ordered them by the loss. So the one with the lowest loss is on top. And that's also the correct one. But what we found was that the incorrect ones usually differ in usually like one new line, or some of the links or hyperlinks are replaced by a variant. So in this case, this is a, it's a, the comment section or the description of a YouTube video. And if you look at the links that were inserted by the model or incorrectly predicted by the model, if you click on them, they'll still go to the correct site. So this is maybe a bit of a lower bound of the attack as well. So if, in a real attack, I think these generations that we created here would also be considered quite useful. Second thing that we already saw in the example is that the suffix which has the lowest loss is usually the correct one, if it exists. So if we were able to extract the correct suffix, it is within contained within those 100 suffixes that we generated, it is usually the one with the lowest loss. So moving to the implementation of the membership inference attack, we consider 100 generations per prefix, and we only consider the generation with the lowest loss. And that reduces the recall from around 70% to 50, but we found in our experiments that this still does improve the performance overall. And we look at a number of features to train our membership inference attack. We take just the loss, which is the numerical one, but we also take two loss, two textual features, the prefix and the suffix. So we will also need to figure out how to program those. And we take the count of unique generations. So we generate 100 suffixes per prefix, but not all 100 are unique. Some of them, there is some overlap, some of them are duplicates. So we count how many are unique. And the intuition behind this is that if you have fewer unique ones, then it's more likely that the model has generated or has memorized for that, sample. Okay, and then we choose a number of classifiers. We select AutoScaler, which is an ensemble-based classifier, and it's an automatic classifier. So you just throw in the data, and it will automatically process the textual features as well, and train an ensemble classifier for you. We also try to do it manually. We selected a couple of scalar classifiers, and to process the text, we use TF-IDF, and we try to deep learning based method, sentence transforms, which embeds the prefixes and suffixes into a very dense space. So what we found was that, AutoScaler is the strongest classifier that we were able to train. But another interesting one is logistic regression, TF-IDF, which is, it's a very relatively simple approach, but still gets very close to our best one. And if you want speed up, then the sentence transform one is much quicker. So the AutoScaler, the one that we ended up using, takes around around 7 or 8 minutes to fully train. But if we use sentence transformers and we feed the embedding into AutoScaler, then it takes only a few seconds to train. But what we can see is that the precision is really high. We get a precision of over 80% for most of these classifiers, for the best classifiers. And that also kind of indicates that it's the generation step, which is kind of limiting our approach. So if anyone wants to further improve this, that's where I would say the focus should lie, in the generation. Lastly, looking at the importance of the features. So we look at the permutation importance for the features that we fed into the classifiers. And we can see that the loss is the strongest indicator out of all. And the textual features, while they have a smaller impact, they do still have a pretty good measurable impact. But the count has very minimal one. Okay, now for our results. So we didn't have the test set when previously, and it's still not available. I guess it won't become available again. So we did the complete attack on the validation set. So from the generation and the membership inference attack to get the final results. And we used our trained random classifier for that. And running on the validation set, we get validation score of 4.13 or 0.413 recall at the 10% false positive, which is what exactly what Nicholas just explained. And what we see is that this is slightly higher than the previous scores that we got, meaning that the validation set is maybe a bit easier than the training set that we used before. But looking at the confusion matrix, we can also see that for the ones that are have the true label 1, meaning that those are the ones for which we actually generated the correct suffix, they're actually a lot more than what we got in the training set. And in the training set, we were able to extract for 50%. Here we're able to extract for 54%, 55%. And that immediately is reflected into a better validation score, which confirms what the intuition that we had about the generation step being a limiting factor. And we can also see that there's a pretty good balance between false positives and false negatives. All right, so to wrap up. I've shown a two-stage attack strategy with a relatively constrained adversary, and our attack is both prompt and tuning-free. We implemented this attack using a contrastive decoding strategy, as well as an auto-scaling classifier. This approach ended us a score of 405, recall 10% false positive, which is 34% higher than what the baseline was able to do for the same set. And all of this while, with a minimal runtime increase. So the addition of the classifier does not really add any computation, extra computational time. Okay, and if you have any questions, comments, or discussions, you can use me over here. Thanks.
We have plenty of time, so if anyone has any questions for Ali, you can feel free to ask. We do have plenty of time.
If you have, I know you said the generation seems to be longer. Say you had a perfect membership and break back, you just knew the right answer. How high would you have gotten in terms of the score?
If we had a perfect membership inference attack, we would have a score of 50%.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the 20%, is that on the validation set you need?
The validation would get 55 on the training set. So I think the organizer also took the last 1,000 samples out of the training set to test internally, or to test, to show how well that baseline worked. And in that case, you would get 50%. Yes?
Contrastive decoding, you use like a second model, right? How does contrastive decoding work?
Contrastive decoding, no, it uses the same model. I'm not 100% sure about the exact implementation of it. We use the hugging face implementation, but I think it looks for, so in its search for the next token, it considers different, so it considers tokens that are relatively far away from each other in the space. And that way it gets dramatically different candidate solutions.
Do you, I imagine you incurred some errors on an example, but that actually gave you some information. Was there any attempt to feed that new knowledge back into the generation to see if it would reorder or what your next claim might be?
No, we did not do that. So that would, that would mean that we would have to tune the GPT-NEO model, which is quite expensive to do. We wanted to keep the GPT-NEO model just as is, but that would, I think, be a good next step, a way to increase the performance.
Are there any takeaways from your experiments that you put different decoding strategies for decoding in regular setting memos, and whether you just trying to generate good text? Like, I could imagine that it might be desirable either to
in general, yeah, this has already been touched on by other works, but greedy decoding is not really a very good decoding strategy at all. Even if you want to make just natural text, which is not memorized, I think beam or contrastive search would both be preferable in that case. And yeah, for yeah, we didn't look at the output if it was more natural or better for between beam and contrastive, but in general, those two are better to use.
Yeah, so
I don't have like a world champion belt or anything or any money, but it's great work, and thanks for participating, and thanks for having such a good attack.
Oh, thank you. Thanks for organizing it. It was a really fun,
excellent. Yeah. Yeah. I think I don't have much else to say. I'll maybe leave you with a couple parting thoughts. This is a really, really nascent field. I mean, we've had like membership inference attacks for a while, but I think the training data extraction world is a lot more new, and there's a lot of work that can be done.